Bam! Looks like people are joining in. Welcome, everybody. It's After Dark with Dave Norona. Ow! That's right. Welcome to the show, 650. We're live. Hey, we're going to start off with a quick hello. And we got Jeffrey Hann on the show today. That's why I got this sled right here. And also, first and foremost, we're going to crack a beer. So if you're joining me, make sure you crack beer. Damn, it's been a hard day. Really hard day. Hope you guys had a wicked day. I hope you and your family are doing well. And last time we chatted to Jeremy Mercier. It was awesome. We talked a little bit about the belt sensor and I had a couple of questions on that. We never got to finish it. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to I'm going to show you, talk a little bit about it. So the belt sensor comes on all the deep snow snowmobiles for 2021. I have it on the, it's on the 20 and a half turbo that was mid-season release. So I just want to touch on how it works. So basically there's two functions or two places that it gets information from. One is the throttle, and I don't need the little cup. I've been, this is my little cup right here. I got the own beer. My wife isn't, you know, slowing me down. So it takes two parameters. One is from the throttle. So say you're out riding hard and you're just holding it to the bar and hitting it, hitting, hitting. Those add up, like, think of it like points, like almost like a video game for all you PlayStation 2 warriors out there. And or you kind of, one, another way is on off the throttle. So if you're in the trees and you're off like that and going maybe slower and then fast and slow, those points accumulated. And that goes into the ECU and there's an algorithm for that. On the other side, it measures the heat inside the CVT cover from the sensor. Now, a lot of people would say you could use a laser sensor, which is actually more accurate, but it would get covered with dirt and it would have to be very in one spot and it wouldn't actually work that well. So they found just the heat sensor works the best for their algorithm. And again, all that happens is as it that heat exceeds a certain temperature and the points add up, when those connect at the algorithm, you're going to get a beep on your dash. I've actually had no beeps. I think Carl might have said they might have had a couple. Tony's had a few, but not much before I lose all my paperwork. And it's not something that also slows you down. So you're not going to get limited power. It's not going to do anything. It's basically to let the rider know that you're pushing the envelope of what the engineers think that is possible for a belt to hold. And all you need to do is come down a bit, let it cool down, and then hit it again. You don't have to stop hitting it. You just got to let it cool down. So where that's really helped on the Can-Am side is when they're desert racing, where it's super high temperatures and they're ripping down the desert and they're pushing through the sand and the whoops. When they get that belt that sensor go off, they just slow down a bit, let it cool, and then they can keep hitting it way faster than blowing a belt and have to pull over. And, you know, it's kind of like when you hit a rocky section, right? You can slow down and preserve your tires, or you can shred them and then have to change your tire, which you lose even more time. So I wanted to make that clear. And so it's also on there. It is on all the deep snow snowmobiles for 2021. So I wanted to get that out of the way and make sure that we covered that. You can always send me questions on Instagram. The other thing I want to say is thanks so much to all the people that have hit me on Instagram this year for the questions. My numbers have increased on Instagram, which is pretty good for an old guy, and they keep going up, which is awesome. So I want to thank everybody. I'm my buddy Jason Jabraki on Instagram. He's shown me a couple of Instagram swimsuit models that I'm trying to beat, I'm trying to beat swimsuit models. So right now I'm doing pretty good. So thank you again if you got all those questions and increase. I think I'm at like 13.9. I'm trying to get to 14,000. That's where the big dollars start. All right. And so we're gonna have Jeff Hann on the program tonight. Jeff, I know you're waiting by the wayside. Please step in when you can, buddy. He's all the way from Newfoundland. So it's a little bit later there. I think it's 3 hours ahead. And Jeff's going to join us. I think he's heard us. Jeff, come on live. Let's make this happen. And how am I doing? Somebody asked. I'm doing awesome. I have a little one, so I spend most of my time with her, no matter what. Here he is, Jeff. How you
I'm
doing,
here. Buddy? I'm good.
Hey, I'm just going to finish what I was saying. So thank you for asking how I'm doing. And yeah, I'm spending most of my time with my little one and my family and in and around all the things that I do and need to do. Of course, spring check's coming up. So answering lots of questions on that, getting ready for all the summer fun. And, but one of the things that's awesome right now is Jeff is here. Jeff, how are you doing?
I am good, Dave. I had a little nap, and it's 11 o'clock at night, so it's daylight where you're at, so 4 hour time difference between me and you.
Yeah, dude. Now, I always tell people a story about the people that are coming on here. So I've been on the team for 10 years now, and we're riding with Skidoo. And so I would say we're all super chill people. We're super fun, but there's no doubt to go on any team, because I've been on lots of teams, like sports with teams, I guess, not in the essential, like a hockey team, but when you're on a cycling team or whatever, you have teammates, and it's always can be very daunting when you come on the team, like anytime after there's been a few people, because there's no doubt you might say people go, well, am I going to fit in? And how are these guys? Are they jerks? Do they think they're all that and this and that? And I would say we have one of the funnest. There's so many great teams from Polaris and Arctic Cat, and all the guys out there are just a blast. So this isn't to say any different than that. But we are super fun. We absolutely love each other. We love what each other does because we're all super different. And I would say, I always say it must be hard to come on a team that's like that because you're gelling. And one of the things when Jeff caught on the team, we didn't know Jeff, is that he is a rad dude. He beats to his own drum, and he doesn't care. I don't think he would care how we were, good or bad. He's gonna do what he's gonna do. And dude, you, in my mind, you absolutely kill it. Now the mountain segment gets a lot of hoopla because we live in the mountains and that's where the kind of team started, but I think it's having you and Charles and Rob, and we're going to talk to Matt Downey on Wednesday, what you guys do and what you do especially with the utility side of it is you really live that life, and you there's no one better who does such a great job of that. And as soon as you came on the team, it blew my mind. It's like way easier for us to be on the team than you coming on the team. You've done such an amazing job and you're such a fun guy. He's a little bit quiet, but he's a thinker. He's not like Norona who flies off the handle and then has to backpedal. Jeff, he's a calculated troublemaker. He's a very, he's like, I play checkers, he plays chess, all right? Play simple, he's the mastermind. So I want to say thank you for all the stuff that you do and that you bring to Ski-Doo and that you bring to the team, and also that you bring to all the people that follow you. If you don't follow Jeff Hann, you have to, even if you're not, if you don't live always on the trail utility side, he's going to show you a new way to live with the Ski-Doo brand and the utility side. So my first question to you is, Jeff, what do you do outside of riding? Because you have a pretty interesting job. Tell us about it.
Yeah, very interesting job. I work for an explosive company, and we pretty much blow up stuff in the mine here in Labrador City. Right? I drive a truck, Dave. That's a tandem truck. We carry about 35,000 pounds of explosives. So I'm sitting on my ass every day riding around the mine. So it's a fun job. It's a dangerous job, but you know, it's a lot of safety features and stuff involved. So, you know, you don't even worry about that stuff, but it's definitely a interesting job, fun job. And so you get to see the end result sometimes of what you do. You spend, you know, a couple of weeks loading holes in the mine and then you get to watch it all blow up, and it's just amazing to see.
Now, I wore this suit for you because it's the TNT special edition that I picked up in Heydays. So, hey Jeff, you know that at 7 o'clock, right, we have this Rev for Support, which is for all our health workers and essential people. So I'm gonna get up on my sled. You got something there that you can make some noise.
Get on the garage door for a minute.
So the noise you might hear is there's a one of my neighbors, she's 11. She gets in that truck. She never wants to. She obviously her parents never let the hit the horn. So she's awesome. And we've started a great thing at Skidoo. It's called Rev for Support. I just want to tell everybody out there, all the people sending in their videos, revving their engines, putting their sleds on sides, spinning the track. It means so much to all those people that are helping so many people. And it's so cool in our neighborhood. We got fire trucks and police escorts going around the hospitals here and all through Vancouver and all over other small towns in British Columbia. So it's super, super cool. So I want to thank everybody. Keep sending those videos in. We also, we lost Rob Kincaid. And so we have that Rev for Rob is it goes along with that. So they all have meanings, and whatever you feel it in your heart, make sure you keep those coming in. They're absolutely awesome. And it may seem simple and it may seem funny, but it really drives home the point of all the people that are helping one another, especially in this time. So very, very cool. Thank you again. Keep sending those in to Skidoo and make sure you tag them Rev for Support. But Jeff, you were saying that you love to blow. Well, you blow stuff up for a living. How much dynamite? What's the most you've ever carried in the truck? You ever take a couple extra boxes?
No, it's almost like a it's like tapioca pudding. Basically, it was a mixture with ammonium nitrate and fuel oil, basically, and it's 35,000 pounds, and it's a big load, and yeah, you load all that up, and when it goes up, Dave, I tell you, it goes up with a bang.
Do you have what side of ear protection do you wear? Do you just have two giant pillows and they duct tape around your head, your helmet?
Yeah, stand really far away. run for cover.
So, question is: has anything ever gone bad? Have you ever blown up a truck at work?
No, nothing's. We're pretty safe here. We got an excellent safety record. I think we're with explosives and stuff. Nothing's ever happened here with anything like that with us, with any incidents and stuff like that. So,
yeah, I know. And I was chatting with you, and I know it's always fun to bug. I have a friend who's a plumber, and all I ever bug him, I always just ask him how many toilets he deals with in a day, as if that's the only thing he does. So I do the same thing with you with blowing stuff up. I always ask you the questions, but I know the company that you work for and yourself, and you guys pride yourself on your safety record. And when you're working with dangerous materials like you are, that's all that counts, right? Is like you want the zero, the number, the zero really matters at the job site, because you don't want anything bad to happen. But how stressful is it on you guys? Like, because it is like when, you know, that is a hard job of you know, just managing that stuff and making sure everything goes right. And there is kind of no room for error.
No, there's absolutely no room for error. And you know, even things like the truck is stainless steel, so if things don't spark, there's a bunch of safeties, like pressure safety sensors, temperature sensors. If you had to sit and think and dwell about it, you'd probably drive yourself crazy knowing what you're doing every day for a living, right? But you kind of get used to it after a while, and doesn't really play in my mind so much. I know it. I know everything's safe, and I know what I'm doing. I've been at it for 10 plus years now, so it's a comfortable gig.
So would you say that you're riding, like you're the skidoo sleds that you ride and what you do, because you do kind of go on these cool missions, is that kind of your away time to sort of manage that? That's like you're the opposite of just going to these beautiful places and camping and fishing and using the ice auger off the back of the these sleds. And is it a nice balance for you? Is that kind of how you got into snowmobiling, or?
When I'm riding the trucks, I'm by myself, and you know, it's kind of like it's sort of like riding a skidoo. You're alone by yourself. You're outdoors. You're driving to the mine. There's no boss, so to speak. So you're in charge of your own thing, riding around and doing stuff. So we're in the middle of nowhere, Dave. Like, we're hundreds of kilometers away from civilization and a big giant hole in the middle of the ground in Labrador City is where we go to every day. Sometimes we go so deep in open pit mine, you go down so low, the sun doesn't even reach you till midday sometimes. So, but no, I've always loved the outdoors and skidooing and stuff. And it's just always been who I am, I guess, the outdoors, especially, you know. Mom, I'd be outside playing all day, and, you know, leave in the morning and 5 o'clock, my mom be yelling at me to come home for supper. And that was it. That was my life outdoors. And it's kind of who I am and who I still am. And that's why skidoo is just, fits in that role like perfectly.
Yeah, very cool. Well, it is similar, eh? It's funny how I guess that mem is really true, is, you know, back in the day it was like your parents never saw you until it was dinner time, and now they can't get rid of you. They want to get you out of the house. So for those aspiring snowmobilers out there that are coming up and young, is you know, now as an athlete, social media is important, but a lot of time, and then when you do the time, get outside, and that's what you're really doing this for, is to be outside with exactly. Your family and friends and experience all these amazing things, whether it's in the mountains or on the trails in the backcountry. It's all the same, for sure.
Exactly.
Hey, I got some questions I wanted to ask you. They're a little bit rapid-fire questions. Yeah. What's the longest snowmobile trip you've ever done in the bush? How many days?
Five.
Nice. What's the coldest temperature?
I'd say we've gotten down to minus 50 or below. Yeah. But in order to do that, you got to wear the right gear, like the absolute zero gear, oxygen helmet, things like that.
Yeah, we'll get more into that, buddy. Yep. What do you call it, a cabin, a lodge, or a camp?
Camp and cabin, kind of both.
Okay.
The camp is rough, and cabin's like fancy, nicer.
It's when you say fancy, that's like a 10 by 10 with a stove in it, right?
Yeah.
What's one accessory you can't live without when you're out there?
One accessory. Cargo box. Handlebar muffs.
What's the highest snow level at your house?
In my backyard, it's almost to the top of the fence now, so about 5-6 feet. It's just slowly melting down.
What's the tallest, though? How many times have you opened your garage to leave and the snow was like above your door?
That don't happen too often here. We just get the cold, the extreme cold.
But it has happened.
We've gotten a couple storms, and I got to fight my way out to the snowblower,
Yeah, he's an animal, folks. This is a guy who lives in the, like, we're talking, when he comes to a skidoo event, I leave usually the day of, he leaves 3 days before.
Yeah.
And not because he goes by dog sled, he takes a plane too, it's just so far out.
Yeah.
What's the biggest fish you've pulled through the ice?
Lakers are huge. Probably around 20 pounds.
Holy cow.
They're massive.
Did he still have a little fight in him, or is that, you know, in that cold condition, they're usually pretty docile.
It's almost like, well, I've caught them in the summertime too, and it's almost like you think you hook bottom because it's just like an anchor, right? It's funny. And then in the wintertime, they don't put up too much of a fight, but you know when you got one on, just the weight.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. All right, so I want to ask you a little bit about winter camping. So when you got into sledding, the first bit, was it sort of just trail riding, or was it going, I mean, I want to, you know, sort of stipulate where you live. I mean, you do ride trails, but not even almost trail-like, as in like Ontario, where there's like, you know, thousands of kilometers of these super fast, amazingly groomed trails that you can, you're off the grid, you're way in the backcountry. So even using a trail just means like the trail that you probably made yesterday.
Yeah. And we do have groomed trails here. There's around 500 kilometers or so of groomed trails, and there's old groomed trails that are no longer groomed anymore, and sometimes you have gravel roads and just trails in the bush and stuff like that. So I always like to go out and choose my own trail and go off and do my own little things. Sometimes I'll use the trail system. I'll buy it. You know, I always support the local Skidoo Snowmobile Club here and buy a trail pass. So I'll use their systems to get further into the bush and that. But going off trail is something I really enjoy.
Yeah. And so when you go, you know, were you always a Skidoo guy?
Always. It's always been Skidoo. It's always everything. Every snowmobile was a Skidoo. And even now, Dave, you talk to some people and they're like, they'll say Skidoo, and it's not a Skidoo, but to everyone, especially Newfoundland, a Skidoo is a snowmobile.
Yeah, it's kind of like Alaska in a way. It's like they call it a snow machine because it's kind of a way of life, you know, for us, for you. Like where I live, it's kind of a toy that gets you to places that you just couldn't get anywhere else. But for you and for people like in Alaska and other places, it really is a way of life. I mean, people have been checking trap lines and tell us a little bit about
like northern, really northern communities in Labrador. Winter, they have no roads and stuff. So their skidoos are their cars and trucks, and that's their means of getting around in the wintertime, the grocery stores and everything else. It's by skidoo.
Yeah. And it's almost more efficient, right? I was in Greenland many years ago, and they like the winter, like, you know, when you think, why would anybody like winter, and you're like, here it's so cold, but it actually is easier to travel. You can get around places that are across the lake, so you got a driveway around, or now just across the lake on your ski-doo sled.
Yep, for sure. Yep.
Yeah, so very cool. So then how did that progress into just more camping? Was it just the adventure and just you wanted to go further, or you wanted to test yourself?
The adventure, trying it out, testing it. Something about, you know, setting up a canvas tent at minus 40 and with a wood stove and going cutting your wood and sleeping overnight, and, you know, it's fun, and I really enjoy it. And then of course you have to be up all night and make sure you got the wood stoked and going and warm. We tried it there one night there, and we got it up at like 43 degrees Celsius inside. It was like a sauna inside. It was like, holy cow, this thing could put out the heat. So it's fun. It's an adventure. I like doing stuff like that. If I had more time, I'd do way more of that stuff.
Yeah, very cool. So tell us about your sort of trajectory into Skidoo. I mean, I get a ton of calls all the time from younger athletes or even, you know, recognizable athletes. It's like, how can I be involved with Skidoo? I want to work with them and whatever. And how did it work for you?
I think it's a passion for the sport, for the outdoors, for everything, and the kind of lifestyle I live and where I live. You know, we have long winters here. It's winter from October till May. I'll be riding out for still another month yet. But I get asked the same question too lots, like, how do you do this and who do you apply to and where do you send, you know, application to? And it's if you have the passion and stuff and the wants and to do this, just don't be afraid to approach Skidoo and just, you know, and show your passion, your interest. And that's pretty much what I did. There was no contest for me, and it took a while for me, and I didn't know if I was going to make it or not, to be honest with you. But when I did, I was surprised and excited and just glad to be here. Super happy.
Yeah. Well, dude, it shows. And I always tell people that, you don't have to try to brag. You just have to do. And I always tell people, I think the best, your best way into working with any manufacturer or any sponsor is working through your local dealer or retailer. And the reason for that is all sales go through that. We pick up our sleds from there. That's who we work with, where we buy stuff, where we work with our dealers on things. And really without the dealers, there'd be nothing there for us included. And I think some people just sort of have this dream that everything just comes from some warehouse, but it's actually not the truth. And you really have to learn how to help that dealer. And if you're not helping your local dealer sell, then you're really not doing your job. There is a case, I guess, you could just be the most magical snowmobiler on planet Earth and you don't have to do anything. But actually, you know, not in our sport. You actually have to work really hard. So that you have to be a good rider over a great rider. Really, you have to be able to ride, obviously. But you have to do so much more than that. Riding is just a small part of that. You go ahead.
There's a lot of stuff behind the scenes that people don't see, that the stuff we do and the hard work and time we put in the stuff. So it's it's passionless.
Yeah. And you're, myself included, you're not saying it to say, well, it's really hard to do and we work like, you know, super hard. It is passion, so it doesn't seem like work. But there is a lot of things that you have to think about and work with that dealer and try new things. And it's just like you almost have to think of yourself as a business of selling snowmobiles and how you're going to do that better for the dealer. And then you're just taking maybe like think of it as a commission and for helping them do that. And so, you know, in that way, that really helps athletes because I'm really hard on athletes. I want them to work. I think they should work super extremely hard, but then be rewarded if they do good things. And most dealers are very like that. Unfortunately, there's been lots of take, you know, the racer handshake is show me what you're going to give me. Instead, it should be, how can I make money for your dealer? And then if I make more money for you, would you help me acquire certain things that I may need in the season? And that's a much better proactive way of looking at sponsorship. And I always say to people, like, it's no different than a job. You can show up to the job, and if your job is to sweep the floors in the garage and you tell the person that you're a great bike rider or sledder, they don't really care. They just want you to sweep the floors. And a lot of people don't listen to that. So they just say, well, I'm really good at this. And it's like, I don't care. I hired you to sweep the floor. So there's a lot of that goes in behind a lot of things that a manufacturer needs and a dealer needs and the whole sport needs, right? As far as, like you mentioned, clubs and all that. We'll get into that a little bit more because I know it's a super big passion of yours. So what's your favorite thing about coming on and being a part of the Ski-Doo team?
When we do our get-togethers and hang around with everyone and all the momentum that leads up to it, I look forward to that every single time. When we finally get together, it's always, you know, something I look forward to. I really enjoy. It's like a big family event.
It is like a family. I would agree. It is like a dysfunctional family in the best way. We have so much fun, and there's so much coolness that comes, but kind of without ego, and that's really fun. So we get to hang out. And we go go-kart racing, and we do lots of different axe throwing, lots of different things. And you've been a huge part of that, buddy. I really enjoy hanging out with you and when we go out to these things and get into trouble.
Yeah, you're hard to keep up with sometimes.
You're my get out of jail free card.
Yeah.
You're the smart guy that gets me out of jail, and then Rob Koning is the guy who puts us in his F-18,
yeah.
And then whisks us out of there at lightning speed before we even knew what happened. So I hear you helped some teams on Kane's Quest. Maybe talk a little bit about that race and how you became involved in it. Someone asked, had you ever run Kane's Quest? I don't think you have, but this was your sort of first entry into it, was supporting a team. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's right. I've been living here in Labrador for like 11 years now. So Kane's Quest is always, it's a huge thing in this town in Newfoundland and Labrador, Canada. So it's always every second year, and a lot of momentum builds up to it. So this year we supported Team 2. They're from the island Newfoundland there. That was amazing to go behind the scenes and, you know, with the racers and see, you know, what their expectations were, what their routes were, what their plans were. So we had two stops, fuel stops for them when they were racing. One day we were up, I think, for 36 hours straight. And it's funny because you talk to racers and you hear them talking about when they're racing Kane's Quest, they get in this state of mind where they're almost hallucinating. They're seeing things and you're just almost falling asleep. But when you're up for 36 hours straight, I can easily see where they're coming from. And I experienced that a couple of times. But yeah, it was fun. And you know, you go to these to the checkpoints, and you don't know exactly where they're going to get there, because we're in such a remote area. There's no internet and service, so you just kind of know when they left, and you have an idea of when they should get there. So we're stationed there at the fuel stop, and you know, then one team comes in, and then the other team comes in, and someone else comes in. And is like, oh, that's our team, and they pull up, and you get the fuel in as fast as they can, and they're gone again in like 2 minutes. So I was like, adrenaline, a little bit of adrenaline for us, for the sport team, but, and then they're gone. That's it. We don't see them no more. Right. So it was awesome being a part of it. And then, I will be a part of it again, next race for sure. Yep.
Yeah. How long is Kane's Quest?
It's about, I think 30, almost 3,500 clicks, something like that.
Yeah. Because race, I haven't done, Iron Dog, but lo and behold, I cross-country skied the Iditarod Trail, which is pretty much most of it. And I wish I was on a sled when I did that. but it was, you know, the Iron Dog is an amazing event, to not take anything away from it at all, because it's an incredible event and it leads the way. Kane's Quest is really a lot more off-the-grid, rough race. Like, some people would say it's even harder because it's rougher. But I think Iron Dog is just, you know, it's been going on for so long that there's more people doing it. There's more people traveling through those villages, because I know on Iron Dog, the only reason why the Iditarod Trail exactly exists is from people traveling from village to village. And that essentially makes a trail, which is then known as the Iditarod Trail. And then those guys go out and race it, which is totally insane. And, you know, there are 500 miles. We did this event that I was doing, cross country skiing it. We went through 500 miles of whoop. So I can only imagine how fast, you know, when you look at I think the lead time of those guys, and Tyler and those guys are doing, is like 89 miles an hour, 90 miles an hour, the winning time. And it puts it in perspective when you go through those trails at that, you know, just going through and then going, these guys are going 90 miles an hour through here, which is insane. And then, like you said, for the duration, and then they, you know, they only stop for those quick food stops, and, like, you know, they're eating as they go, and then food stops or gas as they stop for like the 2 or 3 minutes, and then they're off. So tell us a little bit about the Kane's question, how rugged it is and where it is.
Well, before the race starts, they give you like a general guideline showing where all the checkpoints and stuff are, and there's mandatory 12-hour layovers. So you have an idea of where the race route is, but essentially, you know, guys go out and they do their own scouting and stuff. So they go out beforehand and get their own tracks in, because there are no tracks where they're going to most times. They're making their own tracks. And so they do that, and then they kind of get set up spots for where they want the fuel at. You know, they'll figure out where their fuel depots are going to be set up and stuff too. When we left Lab City and went to the first fuel spot, I think it took us roughly 4 or 5 hours to get there. I think the racers were there in an hour and a half. So this shows, like, when we're at Sleigh and Tow taking our time, and they showed up like quick. They're on the handlebar, right? They're flying through. But it's I guess similar to the other race, the Iditarod, is it? The Iron Dog. But I think the same thing. It's a lot of guys do a lot of scouting and they make their own trails. So it's a little more rough and rugged that way, into the country.
Yeah, so I would say, like somebody just said, I think only a third of the people that enter it finish it. And so there are sort of checkpoints, and then where how you ever get to those checkpoints is kind of your, like, there are places to kind of, like, you know, I don't want to say cut the course because you're not cutting the course, but find your own way that may be faster than another way.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then there's groomed trails, and this year the transmission lines and things like that were off limits. So there's, you know, they set guidelines that, you know, you can't take the groomed trails, you can't take transmission lines, power lines, things like that. So it keeps them in the bush, really in the bush.
Yeah, so it kind of sounds a little bit more like Baja, where you kind of have, you know, people have, there's different courses actually you can check, and you can miss, you might find a road that's smoother instead of the 6 foot whoops where you had taken advantage, but you might have to go a little further to get to that road. So yeah. It sounds a little bit more like that with Cane's Crest, which is always, you know, you can do when it's kind of in the bush and there's no real trails. Other than, like you say, those groomed trails, which you're not allowed to go on. So it's very, very cool. And I think it's a really interesting sort of way to have these races. And I think that's really cool. You had an experience like that.
Yeah.
Were you now, do you have an eye? Do you want to do Cane's Crest? Is it something you'd be interested in? Or
I still got interest in doing that race. Yeah, for sure. And yeah. The support, like I said, even if I can't do the race, the support, just being a part of the support crew, it's an amazing experience. So that's, you know, it's awesome to join in that stuff and even just partake in that.
Yeah. Well, hey, buddy, I would, that'd be something I might have to do with you some year. I'm past my, you know, when I stopped racing, I did so much of it. I was sort of like, no more races, just because it's a different, it's just when you do it lots, it's when you sort of retire from it, you don't really want to do it more, but that would be something I would do as a kind of like Baja, like an experience rather than, like, you know, obviously you want to go as fast as possible, but more about the experience and bringing people along the way, I think would be a really cool thing to do with Ski-Doo, and people could follow it and, you know, like kind of create some fun content out of it. Not to just joke around, because you just can't joke around in those events, but actually capture it to the people while it's happening. So you're not going to be close to the winners. There's no way I would be anyway, but the sort of experience, I think, would just be a pretty cool thing to do. And with someone like you, it'd be awesome.
Yeah, it'd be pretty fun. Yeah.
Cause I know if we get lost, you're going to catch me a fish and pull out that huge tent and get it up to 42. Yeah. That sounds way better. So
I wouldn't finish the race then.
So I want to talk a little bit about clubs, because I'm super passionate about it out here on the West Coast. I think there's so many great people in our sport. They're at the highest level, which I would consider anybody who's been in the sport, like an old timer who's helped out with clubs. And I don't mean any disrespect as an old timer. I mean that in the utmost respect. I've gone to a lot of club meetings and you meet these guys who are in their 60s and 70s, and they've literally been snowmobiling their whole life. They've been, you know, working as a club member and the groomer or the whatever. And I just look at them and just think, wow, like all the volunteer and all that. And they've kind of, like, the sad part is that they kind of don't think that people appreciate them, which we all do. And I always tell them, like, people aren't just going to do things the way you've been doing them, because back in the day, going to everybody's house and knocking on doors and phoning was part of just living. You didn't talk to your neighbor unless you phoned them. And when you got a phone, that was pretty cool to do. Now nobody wants to do that. They just want to do social media, and you get way more people to the events. And so things are changing, and not a lot of those old timers want to change with the times. So there's a little bit of a conflict there. And I always try to be the person in the middle that says, hey, these young people want to help. They just are more directed. They want a job and they don't really want to fool around, and nobody likes sitting in meetings and arguing. And I think that's the detriment of some of the clubs, is there's a lot of, you know, arguing in our sport, you know. So what is your passion in the club format, and how do you help that? And what do you see as a positive way that we could all do better for clubs?
Well, like you mentioned, a lot of clubs are old and they're not up with technology, Facebook, Instagram, stuff like that. And that, I see that here locally too. So when I kind of got aboard with Ski-Doo, I tried to, you know, encourage people to get out and get the trail passes and go do some volunteer work. And I even, in my social media stuff, I'll do videos and pictures, and I'll go to the club. I'll grab a load of wood, bring it to the one of the warm-up chalets. So then, especially on social media, like if the snowmobile club, because there's lots of guys out there that don't mind volunteering their time, and plus it's a reason to get out on skidoo. If they say, you know, this chalet here is low on wood, appreciate if someone will come by and grab a sleigh full of wood and bring it up there. You know, usually people hop on the chance, right? And you'll get guys, two or three guys going to the snowmobile club and looking for a sleigh full of wood and bring them there. It's, you know, if the club appreciates it, everyone appreciates it, because there's nothing like going to a warm-up shack and having no wood there whatsoever. It sucks, right? Especially if it's cold. Like, we get cold here. So everyone, you know, chips in from time to time, volunteers a bit of their time. And I say it's volunteering, but, you know, if you have a passion for the outdoors and skidoo and that, it's just, you know, if you're going out for a skidoo ride, just hook on a sleigh and tow it to the warm-up shack and bring a load of wood up there and things like that. And I try to encourage people to get their trail passes and stuff too. You get some people saying, oh, I don't use the trail system. I just hop on the trail and go to the cabin, or I'll hop on the trail when it's groomed. But the snowmobile clubs, they need those trail passes. They need the money, the funding.
The less, yeah, I would agree. We have
groom the trail, and just things don't get done.
Yeah, I would agree. I have a club just outside my backyard where I ride a lot, the Black Test Snowmobile Club, and man, the old guard there have been amazing. They don't have a new groomer, so they're always fixing it up, and there's always a guy fixing it up and trying to do this, and like it's absolutely incredible. Last year I won the President's Award, which is kind of I was a little bit embarrassed to win that award. I won't lie. I mean, to get people tell you that you do a lot for clubs, when I see what all these other guys do, it pales in comparison what I try to do. And those guys, as I said, when I accepted that award, was literally, I'm a small wheel in a giant cog of all these people past and present who are just doing, out here we have Donegal Wilson and all these people that have just, they've just devoted their life to this sport. And, you know, I always get that a lot too, is like, oh, well, the trail isn't groomed and this, and why would I support that? And I go, man, when you're paying your $20 or $25 or your $150 membership, you're actually not paying for a groomed trail or whatever. You're paying for riding off the back of all these people before us who have set up our sport. They go to the government and talk about keeping areas open. They go to the government and have areas where we're allowed to ride in. They go to the government and get lease titles, and they go to the government and get places to build cabins. And then they build those cabins and they get the donations. And it's like running a business and thinking that you just kind of go out and you got the business. Like, there's so much to it. And all these people have done all this legwork. I can't wait to pay my snowmobile club thing. And although I don't, you know, want it to be overly expensive, I happily give my $25. And man, you know, there's rumor, I don't know what happens out there, but there are people here that swear it. Like, there's women that man these places and they get sworn at and yelled at by these guys and who think they, I don't know, that they're cool in their big jacked up truck. And it just puts a sour, like, who would ever want to work? And, I ask now, as having a kid, I kind of go, is that what you'd like, want someone to treat your kid like that? Because everybody is a kid to someone. And it's the sad part of our sport. I wish that we could get it across, that people just would be like, hey, man, this is like the smallest thing that you're going to pay is a club membership, and be involved a little bit, because everybody has a talent. That they could help that club out. And is it the same out east in your area?
Yeah, you get a lot of that here as well. But we don't have, like, you guys at West have a lot of land issues and stuff like that. And even Ontario and places, so I see it all winter long, guys going in farmer's fields and stuff, and then they'll lose that section of the trail and stuff like that. We're lucky we don't have to deal with that here, which I'm grateful for. And pretty much, you know, we've got endless trails, and even off trail, we can go pretty much wherever we want to go, which is grateful for that.
Yeah, and I would also say that I know back east they have a lot of problems with guys riding through farmers' fields, tearing it up, and then they just say, yeah, enough's enough, you know. And rightfully so for those farmers that do that. And it's sad. It's like how a few bad eggs can actually turn the tables. And we have the same out here, you know. There is a difference between passion and, you know, being unruly. And, you know, sometimes you go to these meetings and you're talking to government and you may not like the way things are happening, but yelling at someone and swearing at them and calling this or that never works. So it really is about sending the right people who have clear minds, who have focused agendas that can help us all. And, you know, I think it's really important when we talk about clubs that, you know, I always say, right, our sport is pretty small in comparison to, say, hockey or something like that. And if we're infighting, we look like we look like bigger losers than we think we are, you know, than anybody else, because we should just try to be on the same page. And I know everybody comes from a different background and they've been there longer and here, this and that. We don't want to lose areas, but we really have to keep a steady head. And people like Donegal and other people from us, the BC Snowmobile Federation, man, they have clear heads and they try not, you know, they know that you can't yell at a government official because that isn't going to get you through the door. You have to come with a proper agenda and written down notes and speak properly, because that's how things get done. And that's why we, you know, again, why club memberships work. The more people, then we can have the right people at the top, who then go to those places. I know Dennis, who's in charge, I go out to the International Snowmobile Conference, and man, he talks to all these government officials and he's the guy who should be there. It's like the way he sort of uses the data in our favor and then talks to these people, it gets them on our side, and that's who we need. You and I wouldn't do that job for free. And so, you know, these guys are volunteering and some of their stuff's paid, and they should be paid, because what they're doing is keeping these areas open for all of us to enjoy. And I know everybody says, oh, it's Crown land, it belongs to us all. And it's like, well, it's pretty easy to have that taken away. And you know, I always think is just getting out is a privilege, not a right. And when you come from that attitude, it really makes you sort of think how you're going to be better and how we can make it better. Right. So moving on, what is your favorite sled in the lineup? I want to talk a little bit about sleds. I also want to talk about that new sleigh we have.
908 turbo engine is my favorite engine.
And why? Why is that?
Why? It's turbo, Dave. It's the same reason you guys are all hyped over your turbo. I've had this now for a couple of years. Welcome aboard the two strokes, you know? No, the power, you know, the 900 ace before was a good, you know, solid engine. But it was, you know, 95, 90 horsepower. It had limits, but with the turbo on top of that now, and 150 horsepower, you know, it's limitless now. So it's, I wouldn't go back now to a 900 ace or even a two stroke.
Yeah, it's kind of the same thing with a naturally aspirated. Once you go to the turbo right here, you just can't go back. And I was at Rotax when that engine was being built. Actually, just the few were being built for the pre-production of bringing it out. And that was a real treat, the stuff that happens there. And so I've actually ridden the 900 ace turbo, and I would agree. I'm blown away how fast that thing is.
Yeah, it's awesome. I can pull the arms off you.
Yeah, and so what would you put that in? What sled do you put that in?
I'm kind of torn, because I like the Expedition and I like the Scandic for the super wide. The Scandic has a nice front end for flotation, but you get a better ride with the Expedition. So it's always, you know, a toss up. You want a better ride or you want better flotation? You know, the Expedition in the woods, you got to be mindful of those A-arms, and the flotation in front is not quite as good as the Scandic with the big underbelly and the pogos up front, right? So,
right.
I'd still ride the Expedition. The Scandic doesn't have a turbo this year, so I'm not riding a Scandic this year.
Right. I get it. Yeah. And people, let's just say this, it's hard. Always people always say, hey, why don't you make this and this? And it's like, Ski-Doo would love to make everything, but at certain points you have only so many SKUs that you can fit on your production line.
Yeah.
And it goes by numbers. Like if the number, I know you might want a 137 free ride, which is not offered this year, but the numbers dictate that not a lot of people do. So in favor of that, now you can get a 146 free ride with the 137 tunnel, and it does all these other things. So it's not that they don't want to do it and they're not trying to corner people and not say they're important. It really comes down to numbers when you're producing them, and they have to, the numbers have to be there. Otherwise it just doesn't make sense, or the cost goes up, and if you lose somewhere, you have to gain it somewhere else. I mean, these are business decisions.
Yeah, it has to be a smart business decision to make a Ski-Doo, and so.
Yeah, and again, that's where passion and business kind of collide, right? We all want we all want our special little things, and why don't they have this? And it just, the numbers have to be there for it to happen. And so tell us a little bit about the sleigh. I know that it can fit a couple of Dave Noronas probably pretty easily.
Yeah, I think you were in that cargo box, I believe.
Well, I arrived in Cancun a day earlier, and I didn't have too many options to sleep, and I had to hide out. So I used that sleigh in the showroom for a night at least.
Yeah. Yeah, the new Link sleigh is it's pretty cool. I mean, a Ski-Doo is customizable, and that sleigh is pretty much customizable as your Ski-Doo with the Link accessories and the things you can do with that thing. So your typical sleigh, usually just a sleigh with a tarp cover or something like that. So with the new sleigh, the Link sleigh, it has a hard top cover, and then different sections open up so you can keep certain sections closed, and you put your Link gas cans on top, stuff like that. So instead of carrying your Link gas cans on your Ski-Doo or in your back rack here, you can throw it all in your Link sleigh. So, and it looks really rugged and tough. And from what I hear, they torture tested that sleigh. So I think it's going to be, it'll stand up to whatever you put it through.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. I thought when I look at that utility stuff, I'm amazed at what you can put on like one of those expeditions, from the ice auger and chainsaw. Yeah. I mean, it's to you to a T. I mean, when you go camping, like you said, you pull your tent out of that huge sleigh, you put it up, you chop the, you cut a tree down, you chop the firewood, you go to the ice auger and get a hole in the lake and fish and cook your fish. Like it's so rad. And it's kind of like the X3s or the Can-Am side by sides now, right? Like you can take one of those over a weekend, and you can have the wine and the beer for dinner and the fishing rods. And we did a trip where we took some sups and we were fly fishing off these alpine lakes and chainsaw. So if a tree's across the trail, you can just cut it down, and then you load up some extra with firewood for the night. It just, I mean, you could literally just go for one overnight or two overnights, and it feels like you're out there for a week because you're just doing so much. And it's like you're really living off the land how we did. And how you probably do in Newfoundland, Labrador, that, I don't do so much in Squamish. You kind of got to go find your adventure, which is why we have these sleds, right?
Yeah. And the thing is, Ski-Doo, they pay attention to what the consumers want, and they see what they're doing. You know, you got that cargo box, it's a massive cargo box, and you got the ice auger holder, the chainsaw holder, axe holder, and integrated the cargo box. So when my Ski-Doo come, this year I installed, the first accessory I installed was that chainsaw holder, and my chainsaw has been in that like from day one. It has not come out. So it's the most convenient, that and the axe is the most convenient tool to have on the Ski-Doo. I mean, like you said, I was ice fishing with my son a little while ago, and we were having a little fire in the lake, and I just went over to the side of the lake there, cut down a dead tree, dragged it over with the chainsaw, and just threw it in the fire. It's so convenient, instead of having to hack it up with an axe, the chainsaw is there ready to go.
I saw the video and I got pretty jealous. I kind of wished I was your son for a little bit.
I
think it's super cool. And so what is your spring check for next year?
An Expedition Super Wide.
Turbo. With the 900 Ace Turbo.
With the 900 Ace Turbo. Yes, sir. That is what I'm getting.
And name your top three accessories that are going on it for sure.
Chainsaw holder, cargo box, and front wraparound bumper for sure. That's must have. Or even the rear heavy-duty bumper.
And do you have one of those sleighs right now, or are you going to be getting one?
Nope, I don't have one.
Oh, Paul Prudhomme, if you're watching, send this young man a sleigh.
Yeah.
And you know what? The good thing about it is if you get in trouble from your wife, which I know you often probably do, even though your wife is very super nice, puts up with a lot, that could also be the known as the doghouse.
Yeah.
that should have been the name for our sleigh, is the doghouse. It's so big and has so much stuff.
Yeah.
It could be the doghouse.
It could, yeah. Doghouse, yeah.
Hey, let's not tell them that. Let's send them an email and we'll get some commission off of it.
Yeah, the doghouse.
Hey, so I noticed you're in your garage. Tell me your favorite tool in the garage. It looks like you got a lot of stuff in there.
I'm sitting on it. My favorite tool is Skidoo.
Okay, well, we talked about that. Name something else.
White's favorite tool? I don't know. Chainsaw, Dave?
Come on, you can tell the truth here. Is there any explosives at all in that shed?
No.
I love it. Well, hey, dude, I want to thank you so much for taking the time. And I hope everybody gets a little bit into the life of you, because you're a really rad dude. And I'm super pumped that you're a part of the Ski-Doo family, because, again, what you do and how you do it, it's just so fun to watch. And I want to thank you for that. So please give Jeff a like on Instagram and Facebook. Catch up with all his vids. Even if you're a hardcore mountain rider, you're going to enjoy some stuff there, and going to probably try and do some of the things that that he does out there. I know I like camping off the sled. And before this sort of hit, we went into way back there and camped at a lodge, like a little cabin and rustic cabin. And man, it's just the best, eh? Cutting your foot firewood, dragging it out with the snowmobile. You know how time goes by so fast. You stop riding at 3 and you think, oh, we got more than enough time, but soon enough it's 7 o'clock and you haven't even eaten dinner yet, because you're just doing all this fun stuff.
Well, it's fun, because and then going to the cabin is like an adventure, because I'll go down to the cabin sometimes the night before and get the cabin warmed up, the wood stove and things like that. So then the next morning when I go down with the family, the cabin's warmed up. And you know, the cabin, there's no power here, Dave, at our cabins. It's bring your own fuel for the generator, bring your own water, bring your own food. So you're down there, you're bringing water, you're going out on the ice and punching a hole with the ice auger. So it's getting, you know, it's roughing it kind of, but it's you know, it's enjoying all that stuff. And that's why I love doing that stuff.
Right on, dude. Well, I want to thank you for joining us. I also want to thank everybody for stopping by tonight and for all of the shows that we've done. We're going to have Matt Downey, the madman Matt Downey. I have a good story for you on Wednesday. He's awesome. And I'm hoping we have Ashley. She's been working her butt off in Valdez, but I'm hoping we have her for Friday. So a big reminder, tomorrow is snow check. So the last day to get your order in, if you want to get a turbo or naturally aspirated or whatever you want to get, make sure. And the other thing I'm going to tell you is I've had a ton of people contact me on accessories. If you're looking for accessories, make sure you make your list and send it into your dealer. The reason is when people start picking up their sleds, that's almost not the time to go shopping, because they start running out of stuff in the shop and then they have to order it. And sometimes they're back order, because once that happens, everybody's ordering. Get the order in now, and then you're first to receive it when the first batch comes in. That's the secret. And I want to thank you, Jeff. Anything else you want to say to all the fans out there?
Thanks for joining in tonight, and give me a follow on Instagram and Facebook, and check out the Skidoo, the Expedition, all the accessories I have on it, and you know, the great utility sled that the Expedition is.
And can you do me a favor tomorrow at work before you blow something up, like when you push down the button, like the Acme, like the coyote? Can you yell out Norona?
Norona. Yeah.
But say it like Costanza. Norona. And then hit the just you. I think your coworkers will get a kick out of it.
Yeah. See what I can do.
All right. Well, you have a good night, buddy, and we'll chat soon. I want to thank everybody, and we'll see you later. Wednesday night, 6:50, Matt Downey. Get in your snow check, and if you have any questions, send any one of us those questions, and we'll get back to you as soon as we can.